Welcome. Welcome to the second day of Tito's 2009. And we're going to start off with a keynote about Ubuntu and the Viable Desktop. Give a big applause to Jan Stedenhouder.
Morning. A little bit about myself. It's nice to be here, by the way. As a non-developer, GUI-based person, it's nice to be here on a technology-oriented event. I'm a writer. I've written two books on Ubuntu for Windows users who want to migrate to an open-source desktop. A general book on open source and open standards for decision makers who want to see what is involved in this domain. I'm co-editor of the Open Source Yearbook 2009 and also of the next edition that will be published somewhere in the spring of 2010. And I contribute magazines, articles to magazines like BSD Magazine and Linux Biz. Let's begin with some confessions. It's always nice on a Sunday morning to start with confessions. There was a church reference already here earlier this morning. I have to wear a black robe, but I'm not here today. First, I write books, articles, not code. I only wrote one program. It was in the way back time. It could draw constellations. It was written in BASIC on a Commodore VIC-20. So you can estimate my age. It was the first school set of computers on my school. And the mathematics teacher tried to teach me code. Well, he failed miserably, same as he failed with me in mathematics. But at least I wrote one program. I still spend significant time on the Windows desktop. Sorry about that. I work in an organization where the majority of people, they use computers as a tool to get things done. They want to file a report at 9 o'clock in the morning and don't want to solve issues. That's the group of users I always have in mind. General users who go to the office every day, and if you want to help them to move to an open source desktop, you have to see their needs and their wants. Of course, I use Mac OS X, Ubuntu, and PCBSD, so I am knowledgeable in open source. I'd like to say I prefer the GUI, but honestly, if I look at the command line, it still has quite some challenges. I don't give up. I try again and again. I still want to do a series of articles, 30 days on Linux, with only the command line, but it will take some time in preparation. Nobody's paying me to be here, also nice. I'm not being paid by Canonical, nor by Microsoft. Sometimes when you're critical about open source, they say you're in the employ of Microsoft. Well, I'm not. And I still believe the Star Trek DS9 is the best series ever. And why the confession? Well, it isn't about technology, not solely about technology. I believe that the open source desktop is technologically viable. But I'd like to show some other perspectives, shifting perspectives. There will be more users that aren't technologically literate, but will be using open source desktops. They will give other demands back to the developers. You will change from a world where scratching your own itch is being replaced rapidly by, hey, you didn't scratch my itch yet. They will make demands. They will say, this needs solving. This is a bug. You need to solve it. And they won't give the feedback you need to solve it properly. So I will show a perspective where fast development meets the needs and wants of everyday businesses and end users. And it also helps to understand the challenges Ubuntu is facing. A few years ago, I wrote down 7 criteria for the open source desktop. There are a lot of Linux distributions out there. A lot of them are very good. But which distributions are usable, acceptable for end users and businesses? 7 criteria. For one, it needs to have a recognizable and easily understandable graphical work environment. End users don't use the command line, not in day-to-day business. It should have a complete set of graphical tools for systems and software management that can be used intuitively. Now, the word intuitively is debatable, because it's a skill you have to learn anyway. But how easy is it to learn the skill? You should support multimedia activities, peripheral devices, without too much hassle, which means that if you have to make pragmatic choices, in the meantime, it has to be delivered by the Linux desktop. The users of open source should have access to business-grade professional support if that is desired. You cannot expect small companies, small organizations to have a full IT staff. maintaining and developing the open source desktop, I think, is very important. It shouldn't be dependent on a single person, a relatively small group of persons. It has to be stable for the long run. It has to be, if you migrate to an open source desktop, you want to be sure that the desktop is still there in 3 to 5 years. It will require retraining, of course, so is there sufficient documentation, good documentation, and easy access to end user support? And it should have a solid track record for quality, stability, and solid progress. You have good Linux distributions that sometimes have very great releases, and the next time you say, well, skip it, because it doesn't work as it should be. Now I'm going to the risky part. This is my list of open source desktop that meet all of these criteria. If your distribution is not on the list, it doesn't mean it's a bad distribution. Doesn't meet my criteria. I don't think it meets my criteria. Ubuntu, based on Debian. SUSE, the commercial Linux distribution, based on the OpenSUSE community distribution. Red Hat Fedora, although Red Hat is more server-oriented, I think it's a bit lackluster when it comes to desktop support, desktop distributions. And the last one isn't Linux, it's BSD. It's PC BSD based on FreeBSD. Some form of disclosure, I'm writing a book on PC BSD right now for end users. Then we come to Ubuntu. Let's talk a little bit about it. It's linked to an African philosophy. It's important in understanding how Ubuntu develops itself. It means humanity to others. I am what I am because of what we all are. And what it says here, the Ubuntu distribution brings the spirit of Ubuntu to the software world. So I decided to dig a little deeper. What is Ubuntu? And Desmond Tutu wrote about it. He says, a person with Ubuntu is open and available. So it says in the last sentence that you belong to a greater whole, and that you as a person are diminished when others are suffering or not having the well-being that you have. So it's a feeling of interconnectedness, of social responsibility, the need to help others. In 2008, he elaborated on it, and especially the second sentence is interesting. We think of ourselves far too frequently just as individuals separated from one another, whereas you are connected and what you do affects the whole world. When you do well, it spreads out. It is for the whole of humanity. That's the philosophy underpinning the development of the Ubuntu distribution. You can also see it, the way they portray themselves in public relations. This is various releases. You can always see persons from various ethnic backgrounds. They're always connected. And as you all can see, they're always individuals. So this is how you, and it works if you look at it. Ubuntu is the most popular Linux distribution for years. It's growing rapidly. It is able to attract new users. It's not just for the technology, but also for the atmosphere they create in the communities. It finds its way in the code of conduct. And if there are conflicts within the community, people are very quick to refer back, no, this is the code of conduct, you see. We have to change our attitude. We have to be more positive and less negative. The new release is due to come out at the end of this month. The beta was released a few days ago. What can we expect? Well, Ubuntu One, for one thing, which is an online synchronizing tool similar to Dropbox. Dropbox was a little bit earlier. The drawback of Ubuntu One is it's related to Ubuntu, and Dropbox is multi-platform. It does the same thing. You drop everything in a folder locally. It's synchronized online. If you install it on various computers, all your documents are synchronized. Sorry, I have a hearing aid, so I need to...
Well, I'm not familiar with Dropbox, so what is Dropbox?
Same thing. it's Ubuntu One for all the other platforms. No, Dropbox is a small program. You can download it on getdropbox.com. As far as I understand it, like I said, I'm not a technology wizard. It's a graphical front end for AirSync. So you have a local folder that's being, you can put all your documents in there. It's synchronized to a server, and every computer you have that program installed on automatically synchronizes all the documents. It's very easy, especially if you work on various locations. Dropbox and also Ubuntu One is free until 2 gigabytes of documents. When you go above that, you need to have a subscription fee. and Dropbox. If I'm correct, it's 50 gigabytes for $100 a year. So it's quite huge.
Can you use it on other platforms? And can you all use other services than Ubuntu One?
As far as I know, I didn't dig into it yet. Ubuntu One is only for Ubuntu, which I think is the major drawback. And I don't think it's you can link it to your own server. But like I said, I didn't dig too deep in it. Dropbox, you can also only use with their own server. It's related to the Amazon cloud. Yeah, which could be a drawback for many users. No, it's not open. Ubuntu Software Store, it's the new app store-based interface for software installation. Ubuntu has a new splash screen. The GNOME Display Manager is changed. We will see about the drawbacks for that one a little bit later in the case of Friends of the Earth. Grub 2, new file system, ext4. It's now by default. As you can see, some other Linux distributions had it already in Spring, but it's now in Karma Koala. Empathy is being used for instant messaging. Surprisingly, they decided to remove Pigeon, but then introduce it again in Alpha 6. It was back, and now it's gone again in the beta, so I guess it will stay away. The decision for empathy is not without discussion, but they decided on empathy because it has some more features down the road. Of course, general updates in the kernel, GNOME desktop, applications, drivers, and a new tool instead of GParted, the PalmSys disk utility. Also, what we kind of knew is a netbook release for Kubuntu, which is new this year, and some images for the Ubuntu Enterprise Cloud and the Amazon Cloud Computing. If you look a little back in history, the various releases of Ubuntu, I will start in 2006, the first long-time support edition. Ubuntu has two releases. One release is one every two years, long-term support edition that gets support for 3 years on a desktop and 5 years on the server. An intermediate, every 6 months you have a regular release. Now when we look back from 2006 to 2009, you can see what has changed in the end user facing desktop. 2006 you feed a graphical installer, the live CD, and then it moves on in 2007. You see the Windows migration tool, so if you have a dual boot desktop, it checks what user information is there on the Windows desktop and you can migrate it to the Linux desktop. Improved installation of codecs, restricted drivers manager. One thing I liked for my laptop was in 2007, Gutsy Gibbon, the automatic installation of firmware for the Broadcom chips. It was very easy. Support for NTFS. And spring of 2008, the Wubi installer, which makes it easy to install Ubuntu via Windows in a virtual machine. 8.10, Intrepid IPEX, encrypted private directory. In spring of 2009, Netbook Remix. And when you see now again the main changes for the end user, the Ubuntu Software Store, Ubuntu One, and the Grub 2 boot manager. Other features, more in the background. You see here the kernel was optimized. You can see the amount of tools for the server expanding. Virtual machines were supported. AppArmor was introduced. Landscape management, 2008, integration with Active Directory. And so it went on. Well, what you can see with Ubuntu, it's not released when it's ready, but they follow a system of time-based releases. It has its benefits and it has its drawbacks. Shuttleworth always emphasizes the positive things, of course. He uses the word cadence. He says, well, fixed release cycles bring stability and you know what to expect. Every 6 months there will be a new release of Ubuntu, and so it goes on and on and on. It does require a few extra efforts, and he's very strong on this, so he always tries to promote the same cycle for other Linux distribution and upstream projects like KDE or GNOME. He emphasized quality. He says we need to go to a system of more automated testing for code contributions. That way, he says, you can change your developer community, it allows for new contributors to contribute code and have it checked quicker than in the current system. And he wants more emphasis on design. He says a desktop should be usable, consistent, and it should fit the user's brain. So it's a very strong end-user focus. An early collaboration between developers, professional designers, and usability experts. In the presentation on LinuxCon, he said even when you deal with changes in the Linux kernel, you need professional designers and usability experts there. Because even the change on the kernel could have implication for how the desktop works. Okay. But Ubuntu, despite all its popularity, despite the progress it has made, it's still popular Linux distribution. There are issues. There is discussion around it. For instance, in the spring of 2008, there was a decision not to include KDE 4 in a long-term support edition. That wasn't nice. I mean, the KDE community didn't like it. Although it's pretty quiet at this point, GNOME 3 won't be included in the next long-term release. It will still be GNOME 2 based. It's still quiet on that decision, so maybe we've learned that when you don't include the next release, it doesn't mean you don't get support anyway. Another issue was to replace Rhythmbox by Banshee. Then it came in the midst of the anti-mono campaign. There's a group in the free software movement that wants to free Linux distributions from .NET influence. So, but as you can see, Banshee isn't the default media player in the Karma Koala yet. So the discussion will continue for a while. Another one was that earlier this year there was the publication of a list of contributors to the Linux kernel, who contributed to the development of the kernel. And some noticed Canonical was almost absent from that list. It wasn't a major contributor. So there was a discussion around it. The counter argument that could be mentioned here is that in order to develop an end-user friendly desktop also requires a lot of effort. So should this be the only test of true involvement? Okay, how much do you contribute to the kernel, yes or no? And another one, more recently, the offer to synchronize the next Debian freeze with the Ubuntu 10.04 long-term support release. And in exchange, Ubuntu would offer extra developers to the Debian project. Still discussion. Schutterward mentioned it in his LinuxCon presentation. He said, well, we're making progress. We're not holding hands yet, but we're getting there. So it's still a long way to go. And Ubuntu One was also a discussion, partly because it isn't completely open and partly because the brand name Ubuntu was used in connection to a commercial offering. And then from the viewpoint of some users, that says, well, no, you cannot do it. The name Ubuntu should stand for free, non-commercial. Well, we can discuss about that. What is the balance that Ubuntu needs to find? Especially with the current crop of users, still mostly early adopters, to find the balance between adding new and exciting and innovative features. People who want to go for the bleeding edge. You have to keep them, attract them to your project. Another one, and that they want to provide stability, familiarity for the end users, so that when they go from release to release, the changes aren't that big. They can continue working. And especially for long-term support releases, you have to ask the question, what does it mean 3 to 5 years from now? Which is something completely different if you just go from bleeding edge to bleeding edge. So simply said, it's the balance between free beer and meeting the needs of a commercial company. Because one way or another, the company Canonical needs to make a profit. What you have to do, what Ubuntu needs to do, is to go from Mindshare, meaning it's the most popular Ubuntu desktop at the moment, to MarketShare, something that can make money on. And it has been said that one of the major assets that Windows has, Microsoft has, is the Mindshare of people. They can translate it into MarketShare. Now, Ubuntu has some commercial interest, commercial partners, like with Dell, selling servers, desktops, although not going too well. IBM They just announced an initiative to provide an Ubuntu-based distribution and cloud service in Africa. And again, the question, why Africa, not Europe? That was the next question in the article surrounding it. It cooperates with Amazon, and it has commercial open source like OpenBravo and Ofresco. If you look at the services provided, Ubuntu Assurance for customer support packages on various levels, enterprise desktop, server support, the premium service engineer, and training. The Ubuntu desktop course is for end users who want to begin with Ubuntu. Ubuntu Certified Professional, Ubuntu Server, and Ubuntu Cloud Computing, which are far more advanced training. In the Netherlands, we have various partners, not too many, but at least they are there. Dutch training partners, AT Computing and Activity. And when it comes to solution providers, you have five different companies. On the Ubuntu Marketplace list, there's a slightly larger group of service providers. So you can see there is, also in the Netherlands, there is commercial support available to use Ubuntu. But how do you go from mindshare to market share? If you look at the analysts, they say the overall idea is that Canonical is moving forward, Ubuntu is moving forward, but it still has a lot of things to do. More desktops preloaded with Ubuntu, more servers preloaded with Ubuntu, and a broader network of partners. Well, Ubuntu is 5 years old, it is doing okay, but there's still a lot of work to do. But the title is towards a viable open source desktop. And to have that desktop is one thing. But what makes it viable for organizations? Viable meaning acceptable, usable, also being in the hearts and minds of users. We'll look at a few real-life migrations. First, a brief focus on the Netherlands. Gijs Hellenius, in last year's open source yearbook, he wrote an article, The State of Open Source in the Netherlands. And he wasn't too optimistic. If you look at the various projects, he said, well, a few small-scale projects. KNMI, the Meteorological Institute, 200 to 300 desktops. Amsterdam, then 60 desktops. ICTU, 20. Octrooi Centrum, patent Office, planning to use 150 desktops, small scale. He also noted that in Europe, various projects were halted or even reversed, like in Vilnius. In Vienna, always the poster boy for the open source migration, they stuck at 1,000 and then made a decision to reserve funds to introduce the next Windows version in 2010. So the migration isn't pushing forward. And Ostrovo South, another poster boy, wants to revert the Linux desktops back to Windows-based desktops. But there are bright spots in Europe, especially in France, large-scale migrations. In Spain, large-scale migrations. Switzerland, 2000. And the Ministry of Foreign Affairs in Germany. We look a little bit broader. Russia, Turkey, Brazil. There you see the major migration projects to open-source desktops. Europe is slow. The Netherlands is very slow. Going there.
Those numbers which we see, are those, does it mean that all PCs in, for example, Madrid are on an open source desktop, or is it just part of the whole?
Not too sure. This is in education, so but I have to look it up. Yeah, I'm not too sure. Yeah. Thought the numbers were large enough already. So then he asked the question in this article, why should governments at least promote open source desktops? So why should governments do it? He says, basically, the policy frameworks are pointing to the right direction. Both on the European level and national level, you see frameworks saying, well, we have to move to open standards. That's mandatory. And we preferably use open source software as much as possible. So it isn't an issue anymore, especially not in the back end. And as Gijs concluded, open source desktops have proven themselves in large-scale migrations. In the Netherlands, migration is slow. Even the strongest supporters, he says, of open source in Parliament don't use open source desktops. So, and the arguments to use open source desktops are reduction in cost. They give an impulse to the local ICT sector, improved competition and innovation. There are also other arguments. We have prior investments, vendor lock, and fear of change. We'll come to the last argument a little bit later. He says governments have a moral obligation. He says they are the largest procurer of software services in Europe. 16% of total investments are governmental investments. So if you want to break the monopoly of Windows on the desktop, as a government, you should invest in open source. So that's his conclusion. But how do you do it? And then we go to Windows. What determines the success of open source migration from the perspective of the end user? And part of the answer is perhaps the Mojave experiment done by Microsoft. You may be aware that Windows Vista wasn't the commercial success they expected it. And Microsoft blamed it partly on bad press. So it was a negative image. And I think in this audience, we can also mention a few other arguments. But this is interesting. Microsoft took 140 people who didn't use Windows Vista yet. And they asked them, what is your appreciation for Windows Vista? It was 4.4 on average, so it was negative. They said, now we'll show you now the next Windows release. And basically, it was a demonstration of Windows Vista again. And how do you like this one? This is Windows Mojave. And the average appreciation was 8.5. So it shows, it's part of a marketing campaign, yes, but it shows that if you portray a positive image, you can influence how end users look at your desktop. And if it's valid for Microsoft, with all its commercial muscle, with all its mind share, with all its market share, couldn't also be valid for open source desktops. Now we look to the east, Germany and Switzerland. What factors determine the success of open source migrations there? Which factors played a role in decision making? Well, they wanted to have more independence, more self-determination when it comes to technology. They want to be more effective, cost reduction. And other factors that were mentioned, although less important in the study, interoperability. Okay, it's nice. Economic development, competition, transparency. So it was to be more independent and more cost effective. Those were the two main arguments in the decision-making process. But then when you start migrating, when you really go to the dirt and implement new open source desktops, what factors played the major part during the migration process? And what it says here, it's the organizational structure that helped. Strong personal motivation, political support. So we're still not on the level of technology, it's still on the organizational levels. Involvement of independent software vendors. When you go down the list on points 12 and 13, we normally would consider those two the most limiting factors. Technology and the expertise of users. They were not very important in the four case studies that they looked into, surprisingly. Interest groups are more important than the skills of the end users. Now we go back to your organization. Well, if you have a flat organization, well, open door perhaps, it's easier with easy access to decision-making levels. It helps during the migration. Positive motivation, you have to convince end users that open source software is beneficial. And political support, let's say the backbone, because every large-scale migration has issues, whether it's proprietary or open source. So you need the backing of those who make the decisions. A similar conclusion was drawn by another study, Beate Kroeshoop and Natasha Zorn. They looked into the migration of the German Ministry of Foreign Affairs. One of the key questions in their study is, like, how often would you change your favorite restaurant? The answer is no, not often. Because if it's your favorite restaurant, you know where to go to, you know the staff, you know the parking place, you know the food, you know the price. So you're accustomed to it. So why would you change it? Same thing with desktops. If you're satisfied with your Windows desktop, why move to an open source desktop? It's your favorite desktop. It's your favorite software. And they say a migration to an open source desktop is similar to other major changes in organizations, so you should use the tools from change management. And what they found out in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, that prior to migration, that 60% of the respondents in the test, in the study, well, that's okay. Why should we move to another desktop? They had prior experiences with open source software, they had prejudices, and if you look at prior experience, it had to do with data incompatibility in previous attempts. But after the migration, so after they started working with open source desktops, that 50% of the respondents understood why it was necessary. Okay, it's cheaper. So that's why we cooperate. But 80% considered the migration and the new applications to be problematic, time-consuming, and without tangible personal benefits. So during the migration, support for open source was reduced. So then something is wrong. You're missing something. So they remedied it. They applied change management tools and three main conclusions. You have to create a positive image. They started an information campaign to the workers. What is Linux? What is open source? What is the decision that is made? What benefits can it bring? Also to you as a user. Second point, create realistic expectations. New migrants got an information kit explaining the benefits of open source, the benefits of Linux, but also the issues that could arise and the solutions they could use. So to make it more realistic. Less evangelizing, more training, perhaps. And work on the competency. So they offer training. It was web-based training that was given prior to actual migration. And it worked. And we can see now that the Ministry of Foreign Affairs is moving forward with its open source migration. In the Netherlands, we have two case studies. One is St. Anthony Hospital in Nieuwegein. This is a quote I took from the NOIV website. I found it basically very interesting because we like to have a rational decision on whether to move from Windows to an open source desktop. And he said, well, we were looking around for a suitable Linux distribution, and the Hobby Computer Club, HCC, they had a special issue on Ubuntu. Oh, that's nice. It looks nice, looks friendly, so we'll take that one. Okay, Stone IT had to do another study about it, but yeah. So it wasn't based on a deep study in the beginning, but simply an issue from an end-user-facing magazine with a special article on the benefits of Ubuntu. And that was enough to build a decision upon in the beginning. Weird, but it happens. And now they are at this point, they started a pilot with 50 sub-notebooks. Well, there isn't any resistance yet, and we were reasonably quick in deciding what we wanted. But some facts about the hospital, 5,000 employees, 250 specialists, and 2,800 desktops. It is a hospital with some experience in developing and deploying open source application. They started in 1997, building in-house application based on one developer that had an experience in Unix. And in 2008, they decided to start using OpenOffice, realizing that from the 2,800 desktops, 1,100 didn't have the proper licenses to use Microsoft Office. And they couldn't remedy the situation easily. It would cost about 500,000 euros. And they checked other hospitals, academic hospitals, and they hardly paid anything because they could use the educational license. But St. Anthony's Hospital wasn't officially an academic hospital, so they had to pay full price. And you know, they decided to go to OpenOffice. And the good thing is the board of directors began. So top down, eat your own dog food from the beginning. Now, like I said, the choice for the Ubuntu desktop was easy, but now rolling it out, that was more complicated. Because as he honestly said in the article, we didn't check the back end and the various applications that ran there. So we started to move forward without really checking it. Another complication, and that's true, is a hospital is a 24/7 operation. So that means you cannot shut down part of the system to implement something new. You have to go parallel. And that means that both have to run 100% and they have to communicate with each other, which brings some challenges. Another complication, the end user again, various users in the organization, in the hospital, built their own applications based on Microsoft Access. And they work very fine. You don't want to get rid of them. So now you have to change that into another applications that are not built by the user themselves, but offered by the hospital. Change management tools again. Get the mind share. They are planning to use 500 to 1,000 desktops before September 2010. I think this is the largest migration in the Netherlands at present, if it works. Another case, Friends of the Earth, the Netherlands, Milieudefensie. It's interesting. This is based on an interview with Paul Roeland from Friends of the Earth. First, some facts. It's a large organization in the Netherlands. It's 85,000 members and supporters that donate money, 90 local chapters. They are part of an international network of 39 organizations. They began in 1972 and they focus on environmental issues. It's an activist organization building awareness, promoting sustainability. Why would they migrate to free and open source software? And they clearly said the key argument that helped throughout the organization is the Max Havelaar analogy. He says, if we decide based on ideological considerations that we want to have fair trade coffee in the cafeteria, why should we settle for less on our computer desktops? So there were ideological considerations to move to open source software. And that struck a chord within that organization. It was made 5 years ago. There were also other arguments, like increased security and reduced cost. In 2005, they made a calculation like, if we would move to the next generation of Windows and Microsoft Office and compare that to Linux, Linux would be 30% of the cost, including retraining. So you get a 70% cost reduction. They took a step-by-step approach. They started with migrating the servers to Debian. They still run on Debian. And then they started to set up a few desktops as dual boot, so both Windows and both Ubuntu. And what they did was also nice, that they had a limited set of applications on the Windows desktop with a large set of applications on the Linux desktop. And one of the other things is, like, you could fax from your Linux desktop, but you couldn't fax from your Windows desktop. And everyone who participated in the test got a new flat screen monitor. And yeah, it helped. It really built support in the organization. And in 2005, they already published a paper like Lessons Learned. The dual boot test was beneficial because you could see the issues with further migration. You could allow desktop users to get used to the new situation. It was used to reduce prejudice against open source. And it says here, phased introduction allowed for corrections in the process. What I said, you have to rally behind the users behind the change, in this case by providing more software and more functionality and new hardware. So, you know, this is the pilot group, this is the best group. But one of the major, one issue that was really strong and that really held back a little bit is specific needs for software. An organization this large, this is partly funded by sponsors, small donations, a huge amount of small donations, and governmental grants. Friends of the Earth needs reliable software for project management, campaign management, accounting, and donor customer relations. And in 2007, there was a study, which option is feasible. And these were the results. They checked into three different solutions. A proprietary Windows-based solution, that was one. Another one was a web-based solution, also proprietary. And they looked into an open source solution. It was then called TinyERP, now OpenERP. And the last one would be ideologically better. But it had a few issues. There was no proper localization for Dutch legal and accounting frameworks. So it might be translated in Dutch, but not for the legal framework. And there was no support at that time from Dutch companies. And if you want to say, okay, well, let's localize it, we invest in it, then you would hire lawyers, you would hire accountants to get it done. And the annual cost, once the investment was done, was around 10,000 euros each year. When they checked it with the annual cost of the other two solutions, they would still be in the range of 200,000, 250,000 each year. So even commercially, you would say, well, let's go for the open source solution, make the first investment, and then get the cost benefits after that. But there was, in 2007, a serious time constraint. Governmental regulations necessitated that TinyERP would be operational at a certain date. And they had 6 months. And then said, well, that wasn't viable. So at that point, they chose for the web-based solution. And in the meantime, they wanted to approach other nonprofit organizations. There are similar organizations in the Netherlands, and invest together. So you can share the investment cost. also not viable at that time, because some nonprofits had recently invested heavily in proprietary solutions, so they couldn't have a second investment. But now in 2009, the situation has changed in less than 2 years. There are now Dutch support companies. OpenERP has a stronger market presence, and much of the localization has been done already. And the board of directors of Friends of the Earth decided to invest in those parts that aren't localized yet, and then release those localizations under the GPL. And the also benefit is that the OpenERP developers speak both French and Dutch, so that it makes for easy communication. Now, including this investment, so the investment they are doing now, the cost of the OpenERP solution is still 30% of proprietary alternatives. So that means that next year they can also migrate the final Windows-based desktops to an open source desktop. Why did they choose Ubuntu? Well, they had prior experience with Debian. They did test out the GNOME desktop and the KDE desktop, and Paul said KDE lost out big time. Why? Is it a bad desktop? No, it had too many options. So they want to have a simple desktop. I also asked him, wasn't it difficult for the users to move from a Windows desktop to a GNOME desktop? He said, well, no. If you move the menu from the top to the bottom, nothing changes. Everyone said, okay, left down, start, and you can find your application. So simple was the solution. And he said Ubuntu had sufficient documentation and online support. They still had a step-by-step introduction. They first migrated the IT department, a three-person department, by the way. Then they had a pilot group of knowledge workers, about 20 users, mostly in campaigning. They used web and word processing. They had prior experience with Thunderbird and Firefox. He said what also helped was the support of an outside activist group in Amsterdam, ASCII. They ran an internet cafe at the time. They did regular surveys, and after 6 to 9 months, the pilot group was expanded. And what helped is that the IT staff sat next to the user during the migration. But what are you doing, and why do you do it this way? So they retrained on the job. He says the total migration for the whole organization was 2 to 2.5 years. And it's only due to the time restraint. So that we want to have someone free to sit next to the user when he starts working on the open source desktop. And still, at this point, the only Windows desktop in use are used by the financial department. Like we said. So we're waiting on the OpenERP solution. Doesn't mean that there are no issues with Ubuntu and open source, and that might be nice for developers. And he says one major issue up to this point is complex spreadsheets. He says OpenOffice doesn't have the same features as Excel and not completely compatible. And they did find a solution. The more complicated spreadsheets, they now are now part of an intranet solution, and all the data is stored in a database, Postgres or MySQL. So they're finding the solutions to solve, for instance, pivot tables. They use Google Maps, not OpenStreetMap. He said, well, because part of our work is building support for sustainable growth, to inform people about environmental issues. And with Google Maps, they can add their own data sets with raw environmental data and present them in an attractive way. So that's why they use Google Maps instead of OpenStreetMap. The mail merge wizard, he says, it's not nice. He says, secretaries do other things with OpenOffice than we in the IT department. And the secretary staff is complaining about mail merging. And they also gave feedback to the OpenOffice.org project about it. Another problem that's for Ubuntu is that concurrent use, so that if someone opens a document, you get a message that it's already open. Under Ubuntu default, you don't get it. And he says, we have to recompile OpenOffice.org from the beginning. Pulse Audio was introduced a few releases ago. He said it was not nice, because we have remote-mounted home partitions. So the sound is getting awful. And for Carmen Kowali says, the new display manager uses a face browser login. Very nice, he says, if you have 2 or 3 users. It isn't nice with 150 users, which are stored in LDAP. He says, so it might be good for a home user. It isn't, taking into account the needs of organizations, larger organizations. They made some, sorry? Did you see it already? No? Well, if you go to GDM now, you now see a nice picture and you can click on it and your name. So you have 150 people instead of, you can enter your name and... Sorry? I'm not sure yet. According to Paul, not. But they will find a solution. They will find a solution. Okay, so, sorry, I have...
They probably, if it's an open source desktop, you can change the one you don't like for the one you do like.
What Paul said about also in the interview, and I didn't put it on the sheet, he says, stick to the default desktop as much as possible. That makes it easier to manage. So the solutions you can provide, you have more tailor-made solutions, it makes it more complicated. Okay, they may also made some pragmatic choices. They use Skype, which is closed source. He said simply because a large number of our partner organizations abroad use Skype, so we need to communicate with them. MP3 instead of awk, Acrobat Reader, Flash, VLC, and Google Maps. Simply because of the functionality, they say it's open source solutions aren't that viable. Sorry, media player. Yeah, but the codecs aren't, not all of the codecs. That's the point, yeah. So how much did they save with these solutions? Say, well, difficult to estimate, but check the following facts. He said the number of users rose from 50 to 120 during migration. The IT budget was decreased over the last 6 years, so more users, less budget. And we can serve 150 users with a 3-person IT department, and annual savings are about 30,000 to 50,000 each year. So it's quite a lot of money. If you think that a lot of work by Friends of the Earth is supported by small donations by people in society, every 10 euro you can save and spend somewhere else is a real benefit. So these are the 4 case studies. And now we still come back to the question, what is needed to have a viable open source desktop? Well, one, it needs to be available, and that's a challenge for developers, designers, and usability experts. And it has to become acceptable. That's a broader challenge. It's a different challenge. What we can learn from the various case studies is the following. There needs to be a clear political signal. This is where we're going. We're going to use open source and open standards in society, in government. And then a strong management focus. So you know, this is what we're going to do in our organization. You need to be clear on the role FOSS can play within your organization and create a positive feeling with end users. Cost reductions alone won't win the project. And also not providing better software, better tools. Because technology is very low on the list of end users. So what is needed on a more fundamental level, and this is my main point, is to improve the level of technological literacy in society. Technological literacy goes way beyond, like, I can have a mobile phone, I can use the interface. But like it says here in the second paragraph, it's comprised of 3 interrelated dimensions, like knowledge. A technologically literate person understands technology, and there are various points here, how it can pervade everyday life. Third point, you know what the nature and limitation is of the design process, at least you have some basic meaning about it, understanding about it. You know how it shapes human history and people. And then the point knows that all technologies entail risk. That sometimes you can anticipate them, sometimes you can't. This is combined with ways of thinking and action. A technologically literate person can ask questions about the new technology. And the last point, can participate in decisions on it. Meaning if you have more end users that are technologically literate, they can provide better feedback for developers, for project management, etc. And you have to have a large, you have various capabilities, like, for instance, you understand mathematical concepts. If you have a technological literate end user, you have a stronger end user. And the majority of end users at the present are not technologically literate. In education, they have learned to work with a Windows desktop. And they've learned to click on the proper icons. But when they have a problem, they have a problem. And they call you, my computer won't work anymore. And what do you mean it doesn't work anymore? Well, I cannot fax. Okay, what does it mean you cannot fax? No. So we have to ask a lot of questions. The technologically literate user can provide better feedback. I believe that if we want to stimulate this technological literacy, and that's perhaps a challenge for the Ubuntu community as well, we will have to ask questions about how we communicate with end users. We have mailing lists in the open source world. It's a great tool, but is it the proper tool for end users who are not literate at this moment? IRC, also a great tool. But if you see 5 or 6 conversations going on at the same time, and you ask a question like, "Yo, my computer doesn't work," are you at the right address? We also like to focus on our wikis, because wikis are great. You can add all information in a wiki. Main complaint from end users, how do I find the proper article in the wiki? Because some wiki articles are outdated. And they also provide information, like if you have, also in the forum, forum is also great. But do end users use forums? If they ask a question, they say, well, use the search function first. Okay, I have a problem with my camera. It won't load the photos. Or you get a solution, well, if you have to install software, open the command line interface, enter apt-get, install. Whoa. There goes the end user again. Yeah, and if you start a discussion about it, yes, but it's far easier to explain in a forum if you use the command line than, you know, go to system, administration, click there, click there, click there, click there. Yeah, but that's what the end user needs at the present. So how do we provide introductory information? How do we coach new users and how do we promote their involvement? Otherwise, we run the risk that communities of early adopters remain communities of early adopters and not tailor the needs of the new group of users that will come. They're less literate, but they're just testing out the waters. And I believe that this will have an impact on other communities as well, developer, vendor-based, and customer-based communities. So we come to the final point, is that we need strong commitment. If you go to open source software, there's a need for strong commitment. John Kenneth Galbraith had the following quote: faced with the choice between changing one's mind and proving that there is no need to do so, almost everyone gets busy on the proof. So can you explain to me why we should go to open source software, or can you explain to me why we shouldn't go? The majority of reports you get will be in the second part. That's why I found it interesting in the Dutch policy framework, it says comply or explain. So that means if we follow the line of Galbraith, most people will start explaining why we don't comply. And then we check off the trip to the moon. Kennedy said in May 1961, before this decade is over, we, America, will have a man on the moon and also return him safely to Earth. This was nice, of course, that he could come back. And Neil Armstrong in 1969 could say, well, this is a small step for man, but a giant leap for mankind. We reached the moon within a decade. What was needed? Why it was important? Well, finally, America had a clear goal. It was in the midst of the Cold War. There was a space race going on, and America was losing, big time. And the Soviets were there first. First man in space, first woman in space, first dog in space, first someone who cycled the Earth in space. And America was barely scratching, okay, we finally reached space. So we could shoot someone in the air and he landed safely. No, we will go to the moon. So that put an end to all legacy discussions. There was no legacy. There was no chance, but nobody tried it before. No, we will go to the moon. Kennedy didn't ask for a report. Can you explain to me why it isn't feasible to go to the moon? No, we only want reports. What do we need to get there? And provide solution. So no comply or explain, but comply and commit yourself to it. It's a clear goal. The future situation became the point of reference, not the past or the present. And did it work? Yes, it did. We know mankind went to the moon. But what Kennedy also said, if you make a decision like this, we need a major national commitment of all manpower. Everyone involved should push forward to finding the solutions. If it's in education, if it's in science, engineering, technical, contractors, civil servants, everyone rallied behind the same goal and achieved it, finding solutions. Question, are large-scale migrations to open source desktops that different from going to the moon? it's a smaller project compared to going to the moon. A lot of tools are there. No, it doesn't say, if you say we'll go for strong commitment, you don't say, okay, this is our current situation, and then you ask the current users who are not yet have a mindset for open source, you know, this is our situation. What can we open up in our current environment? Maybe we can try out Thunderbird. Or maybe we can have a web-based application. No, you go the other way around. In the next 5 years, I want an organization that is 100% open source and open standards. What do we need to get there? How do I open up my backend, my databases, my tools, my applications landscape, my desktop, my data? How do I open up my users? Yeah, wrapping up. And what intermediate solutions need to be implemented along the way? So you look again at the future. My conclusions at this point is that open source technology has reached a level of maturity that is viable for large-scale deployment in organizations and for new groups of users. It isn't a major technological challenge anymore. Ubuntu is positioned to play a pivotal role in that. It is an end-user-facing desktop which has managed to attract new users and still develop the tools to make it easier to work with it. The Ubuntu ecosystem is growing. You see services, commercial offerings that make it viable for organizations. Becoming a completely open organization with open source software desktops might not be simple. It's less difficult and sometimes lives in the minds of people. Imagination and vision are powerful tools to achieve that 100% open organization. The lack of vision, lack of imagination is more limiting, I guess, I believe, than insufficiently developed technology. It isn't a technological issue anymore. So pushing open technology should be accompanied by a similar push of technological literacy. We have all this combined together. You can move forward to a viable open source desktop. Thank you. Do we still have time for some questions? Okay, so enjoy the rest of the day. There are various tracks going on, and, well, support each other. Thank you.